Phoenix, and welcome to the House of Mystery radio show. This is the place to come for true crime, conspiracy, and alternative history. Only on KFNX 1100 Independent Talk Radio. We're here every Saturday morning, 6 to 7 a.m., and I'm your host, Al Warren. Welcome back to the House of Mystery on KFNX Phoenix, and today we're going back into Zodiac, and we have a special guest with us to talk about the crimes that happened, Michael Butterfield, and he's a freelance artist and writer. He's spent a lot of time doing extensive research on Zodiac. His website, zodiackillerfacts.com. Thanks for taking the time to be on the show with us today.
Well, thanks for having me on.
It's a pleasure. There's always so much to talk about on this subject. let's first of all go over who you are and how you got into the Zodiac.
Well, I'm a writer, and I've been following the case since I was a teenager. I first heard about it, I think, when I was 12 or 13. And, of course, I was one of those people who bought the book Zodiac when it came out in 1986. And, you know, I, like many people, assumed that book was nonfiction and that what was in it was true and that it looked like the individual implicated in that book was probably the Zodiac. But after a few readings, I started to notice some of the problems with that book. And I soon realized that you can't depend on other people to tell you the facts, and most certainly not all the facts. So I started doing some of my own research because I wanted to know for myself. And later on, there was a friend of mine who was interested in doing a documentary film, and I did a little bit of research for him. And so this research material sort of accumulated over time. And then I decided that I would like to write a book about it. I did a lot of research. I wrote a book that I have had for a few years now, and on and off again have tried to do something with, but for the most part, it's because I want to know for myself, so it's my own little personal journey. You know, I've done a lot of radio interviews. I've been on television, shows like Case Reopen for the Learning Channel and Mystery Quest for the History Channel. I was a consultant on the film Zodiac by David Fincher in 2007. But, you know, I'm a private citizen who does this not so much as a hobby, but as a special interest that keeps me going.
So what is it about the Zodiac that really intrigues you, I guess?
Well, there's probably two answers to that question. The first is that I hate mysteries. You know, I love watching Columbo, where he figures out who did it at the end. I just cannot stand mysteries. So part of it is that it's an unsolved case, and it's remained unsolved for my entire lifetime. I was born in 1969, so I'm the same age as the Zodiac case. And I think the other answer is that the Zodiac is unlike most serial killers. But he is very much like the kind of serial killer which you'll find in film and fiction and television, in the sense that he's kind of almost seems like a supervillain, in the sense that he calls the police to report his crimes, he sends scraps of victims' clothing with handwritten letters that taunt and warn of future crimes to come. He wore an elaborate costume at one of these crimes that featured a crossed circle symbol on the chest, almost like a comic book villain. He sent many letters and ciphers, some of which remain unsolved to this day. He sent greeting cards with phrases like, you ache to know my name, and I'm sorry I haven't written, but I just washed my pen. He quoted at length from the Gilbert and Sullivan musical, The Mikado. He sent his own movie review of the film The Exorcist, which he described as the best satirical comedy I have ever seen. So he's not your garden variety serial killer. He's very difficult to forget. And I think that because of that, he remains a very sinister figure in the annals of true crime history. And because it's unsolved, the interest has grown over the years. I think that a lot of this feeling about the killer, a lot of opinions about the killer being, you know, like a master criminal and things like that, a lot of those things might disappear if we ever learned who he was and found out just how ordinary he was, sort of like the BTK strangler.
Right.
Once they found out who he was, you know, he was a animal control officer and a president of his church with a, you know, some pretty weird sexual obsessions. But before that, you could fill in the blank with anything you imagined. And the Zodiac case is a blank page in the history books. And because of that, people can project onto it whatever they want, and they do. And that's why the case is so confusing, at least as far as public perception goes. And one of the reasons why the case is sort of part of public domain now, where people seem to do with it whatever they please.
So now, how many murders do we know that he did for sure?
Well, I think we have to be clear and say we don't know for sure which ones he did. But we do know that there are a series of crimes for which he took credit. There was the first shooting of two teenagers on Lake Herman Road near Benicia, California on December 20th, 1968. There was another shooting of a young couple at Blue Rock Springs Park in July of 1969. Shortly after that shooting, some of the Zodiac letters began appearing, being sent to local newspapers. Then there was a stabbing of a couple at Lake Berryessa in September of 1969. That's the incident where the attacker wore this bizarre hooded costume and he left a handwritten message on a car door of the victim. And then a few weeks later, there was the murder of a cab driver in a wealthy neighborhood in San Francisco on October 11, 1969. And a few days after that was the first letter that contained a piece of that victim's bloody shirt. Those are the only crimes that the Zodiac took credit for and specified. He indicated that he may have been responsible for the murder of a young girl at near Riverside City College in 1966, and also indicated that he may have been responsible for the failed abduction of a pregnant woman and her daughter in March of 1970. He alluded to other crimes. He often included at the bottom of his letters a little Zodiac symbol, and then it would say a number next to it. And that was often interpreted as a claim of victims. And that number, the last one that we got in 1974, which was the letter that I believe was the letter that talked about the exorcist, that number was 37. Now, we don't know if that was just a number that he wrote to mess with people's minds or if he did kill 37 people. We don't know for sure that he killed the people that he claimed to have killed. But those four crimes are what are considered the Zodiac crimes.
And so they happened in 1968 and 69.
Mm-hmm.
And then his letters continued till 1974, but there were no murders between 69 and 74 that we know of.
That's correct, that we know of. And there was a period in 1971, in March of 1971, he sent a postcard, and there was a period of silence until January of 1974 when a series of letters showed up, and those letters did not use the name Zodiac. And I think we should clarify for your listeners that unlike other serial killers who have nicknames that are given to them by the media, the Zodiac Killer gave himself that name. And the second letter that he sent in August of 1969, that letter began with the phrase, "This is the Zodiac speaking." And most of the letters after that used that phrase or referred to that name. The letters in 1974 did not use that name. Some of them were signed something like a citizen and things like that.
So do we know if those letters in 74 are by the same person or not really?
There's been some contention about it over the years. If you look at the FBI files and things, you'll see that throughout the years, there were various attempts to have a handwriting expert examine the letters and determine which ones were written by one individual. But the consensus among many of the handwriting experts who have examined those letters is that those letters in 1974 were most likely written by the same person that wrote the letters in 1969, 1970, and 1971. However, there were letters that were sent throughout that time that were believed to have been a Zodiac letter and then proven not to be through handwriting analysis or other means. And then in 1978, there was a famous letter that showed up at the San Francisco Chronicle that said, "I am back." And many experts have been torn over that. The consensus seems to be that it's a forgery, although some people did believe it was authentic. But most researchers that I know of, most investigators that I've spoken to, seem to believe that the letters stopped around 1974.
It seems strange that, I've covered a lot of serial killing, and it seems strange that someone is a serial killer for 2 years and stops. Because in general, there's some sort of drive to do it. And quite often, they start even before we notice them. You know, they start as kids with dogs and animals and other killings before they make it as big as Zodiac, let's say. So do you find that strange as well? Or do you think that perhaps, I just don't see them turning it off.
Well, and I think that's a legitimate concern, especially when you consider the fact that many of the serial killers that we have heard about over the years had careers that began before the crimes for which they are famous. Ted Bundy was famous for the series of crimes that he committed in Washington State and other places, specifically the abduction of two women from a park. And then there was a series of murders after that, and then after he was captured, he escaped, and the second time he escaped, he went to Florida, and he committed a series of murders there. And that's what most people think of when they're talking about Ted Bundy. But there's a whole series of murders before that that many people believe he may have been involved in, including some investigators who believe that he may have committed his first crime when he was about 14 years old. He denied that later on. But that's the irony of what we're talking about. You can't depend on a serial killer to be honest with you about when his career began. And a lot of experts will say, excuse me, that a serial killer is more likely to cover up a crime when there's certain circumstances that are involved, namely if the victim is young or a helpless person, if the crime was particularly brutal in the sense that they would be embarrassed to have people know they did it, and if the crime was too close to home or the victim was somehow linked to them. So it's perfectly possible that the Zodiac committed crimes before he was the Zodiac, you know, before he used that term or that name. And it's perfectly possible that he kept doing it afterwards. There was a time in the early part of the case where the Zodiac killer wrote a letter. He was very upset about something that the police had said about him. And it was basically one of these letters that was saying, like, "I'm really mad at you and I'm going to take my ball and go home," kind of thing. And in that letter, he said that he was not going to tell us which crimes he was committing, that he wasn't going to announce his murders anymore, and that he was going to make them look like routine robberies or killings of anger or fake accidents and things like that. So it is very possible that the Zodiac had another career, just not under the Zodiac persona, As I mentioned earlier, he was a suspect in a murder in 1966. There's some people who believe that he may be connected to a double murder that occurred near Santa Barbara in 1963. I personally have always had a little bit of trouble believing that his first murder was the shooting of the young couple at Lake Herman Road, particularly because it's so brutal. One of the victims was shot like at point blank range right in the head, and the other victim was shot several times in the back as she was trying to run away. I've often had trouble believing that that was the act of a first-time killer. So it's quite possible that there's a lot more to the story that we don't know about.
Well, and also I another thing I notice is each one of these killings, it's kind of, they're different. You know, typically, like, you know, bring up Ted Bundy. He's looking for a particular, you know, a girl, a certain age. Quite often there's a, you know, a formula to what they're looking for. Each one of these victims were quite different, like even the cab driver didn't fit. So he wasn't looking for a particular age or male, female, or anything like that.
That's true, and I think one of the things that you would notice, even if you just looked at a list of his crimes, is that they do appear different. But I think it's important to note that there's a difference between a killer's method of operation, their modus operandi, their MO, and what someone like Dr. Robert Keppel would call a signature, which is something that the killer needs to do or does habitually or without even realizing it themselves at the crime scene. It's not unusual for crimes that are committed by one person to not have any particular link between them. You know, the murders that Ted Bundy committed, there was no evidence that connected those crimes whatsoever. They were similar in the sense that women had been abducted. Some women had been coerced away from locations. You know, the famous stories about Ted Bundy using a cast on his arm to convince people to help him carry his books to his car and those kinds of things. But it's not unusual for crimes that are committed by one person to not fall into a particular pattern. And while the Zodiac, if there was one person responsible for these four crimes, there were different weapons used, you know, different guns were used. So it appears that at the very least, the killer was trying to make an effort to not use the same pattern over and over. Now, there's a difference between making an effort to not do the same thing over and over again and not trying to link the crimes. Most serial killers don't write letters to the newspaper telling them which crimes they've committed. So the fact that they seem different is not in and of itself a reason to doubt that they are connected. One of the things that is probably interesting to point out, of all the crimes that the Zodiac claimed credit for, he seems to have conveniently chosen crimes which remain unsolved. Now, some people will tell you that there were suspects in these cases, that, or that the cases had been solved and the police covered it up or, you know, framed someone else for it or things like that. And there's no credible evidence to support those claims. These cases remain unsolved. The law enforcement agencies are still investigating these cases as if they are unsolved. And so it's fortunate that the killer took credit for crimes which would remain unsolved, because if you picked up a newspaper today and you saw that someone had been shot somewhere and then you decided to write a letter to a newspaper taking credit for it, you don't know that the very next day it's not going to be solved. It's also important to note that the Zodiac crimes, while they were different, there was two shootings of couples at a Lover's Lane spot at night. There was a stabbing of another couple during daylight at a lake. And then there was, of course, the murder of a cab driver in a wealthy neighborhood at night. Those do seem to be very different crimes. However, they do have several things in common. The killer, there's no apparent motive in any of these cases. Even though the Zodiac took the piece of the shirt and the wallet of the last victim, there's no evidence that he committed this crime to rob the cab driver. There's no evidence that he committed any of the other crimes for robbery or sexual assault or anything like that. The killer never made any attempt to interact with his victims or transport them to another location. He simply attacked them and left them there and left the scene of the crime. He made no particular effort to make sure the victims were dead, which is rather ironic because in the first shooting, he shot someone at point blank range in the head. In the last shooting, he did the same thing. But in between, there were two survivors. And the two female victims who died at Lake Berryessa and at Blue Rock Springs, they both survived for a period of time after the shooting. And what's even more disturbing is that the killer, after Blue Rock Springs, someone called the local police department and reported the crime and directed the authorities to the crime scene, which increased their odds of surviving. The same thing occurred after the stabbing at Lake Berryessa. Somebody called the local police department in Napa and reported the stabbing and directed them to the crime scene. So while there are things that are different, there are some similarities. But again, the fact that they're different is not evidence that they're not linked.
Now the two survivors, witnesses, were they able to ID what this person would be, and was it a very similar identification if they did?
Not really. For instance, Michael Mageau, the victim who survived the shooting at Blue Rock Springs, according to his own statement to the police that night and shortly thereafter when he was interviewed in the hospital, he was sitting in the car with Darlene Farron at Blue Rock Springs Park at night, and a car pulled up. Person got out and walked towards the car, shining a light at them. And this light was in Michael Mageau's face. And almost immediately, he was shot in the jaw. And then he was shot again, and as he tried to jump into the back seat, he was shot in the leg. When he was interviewed, he told the police that he only saw this person in a profile view for a very brief period of time when the person had emptied the gun, apparently, and was starting to walk away. Michael Mageau said that he made some sort of sound, like a moaning or groaning sound, and the person apparently reloaded and came back and shot into the car several more times. So he said he'd only seen this person for a brief instant from a profile view. Flash forward to 1991, I believe, which is 22 years after the shooting. Michael Mageau was shown a photo lineup by the retired detective from the Vallejo Police Department. And in that lineup was a photograph of the suspect favored by the Vallejo Police Department, Arthur Leigh Allen, the man who was the subject of Robert Graysmith's book Zodiac and the film Zodiac. He was a convicted child molester who became a suspect during the original investigation. They showed this photo lineup to Michael Mageau. And Michael Mageau pointed to a picture of Arthur Leigh Allen and said, "That's him, that's the man who shot me." And that's how that story was reported when it first leaked on the internet. That was really all the details that we had, and it took quite a long time of probing and checking on my part with the Vallejo Police Department to finally get them to give us the full story on it, which was that he did say, "That is the man that shot me." But then he pointed to the face of another person in the lineup and said he had a face like that person, which is an extremely odd statement, because what he was basically saying was it was Arthur Leigh Allen, but he had this guy's face. And that's not a positive identification. The police department did not consider it a positive identification. And I spoke to Detective Ed Russ, who was the detective who interviewed Michael Mageau in the hospital immediately after the shooting. And he said that he did not believe that Michael Mageau could positively identify anyone, even back then, let alone 22 years later. The other surviving victim, Brian Hartnell, in that instance, the attacker was wearing that hooded costume, so he could not see the person's face. The other victim, Cecilia Shepherd, apparently saw this person's face shortly before he put the hood on. but she did not survive to give a very detailed description. Brian Hartnell believed he saw some greasy brownish hair underneath the hood when there were holes cut in the hood for the eyes, and the person was wearing a pair of clip-on glasses there too. So he said that he saw a flash of hair for a moment. He was taken at one time and asked to observe Arthur Leigh Allen, and he said there was nothing about his build or his voice that would rule him in or out as a suspect. The descriptions of the Zodiac Killer vary a little bit. For instance, at Blue Rock Springs, the killer is described as having short, brown, almost curly hair. Person who was seen at Lake Berryessa, a person who was considered a person of interest, had brown hair combed down straight over the forehead. The person at in San Francisco was had brownish, reddish hair and a crew cut. But the overall descriptions of them, their size, height, weight, things like that, seem relatively consistent. And I'm sure that you know, just like anybody else who's followed any crime stories, that eyewitness descriptions are notoriously unreliable.
Yeah.
And people who think they've seen one thing will later discover that they were wrong. I don't know if you've ever seen those experiments they do in law classes where they'll have a professor up at the front of the class giving a lecture, and the professor's in cahoots with somebody who runs into the room and grabs a purse and runs out or does something like that. And then the professor asks the class and the students to describe the individual that they just saw. And more often than not, the descriptions are horribly inaccurate, even though these people saw this right in front of their own eyes just minutes ago.
Yeah.
So the discrepancies between the Zodiac descriptions, they could indicate that more than one person was involved. Of course, that's possible. But the most likely explanation is that it was one person who was viewed by different people from different angles in different light at different times, and therefore some of the details are not going to be consistent.
Now for the listeners, on the letters that Zodiac wrote, there were ciphers. So maybe talk about that. Explain what that means and what he was trying to do with that.
Well, I don't know what he was trying to do, but I do know that if he was trying to keep people busy for 47 years, it worked. people are still trying to crack those codes today. The very first one was sent with the very first series of Zodiac letters. The first letters showed up. The shooting at Blue Rock Springs was on the night of July 4th. And on July 31st, the San Francisco Chronicle, the San Francisco Examiner, and the Vallejo Times-Herald each received a virtually identical handwritten notes that said, "I am the murderer of the two teenagers on Lake Herman Road last Christmas and the girl on the 4th of July," and proceeded to offer some details that were relatively accurate about the crimes. But each one of these letters also came with one-third of a cryptogram. Each piece was a one-third of this code. When it was put together, it was supposed to be a complete message. And the writer demanded that the newspapers publish this code, and he said that in this code is my identity. So the newspapers published their portions of the code. And it was solved by a teacher and his wife, who discovered that the first line said, "I like killing people because it's so much fun." It went on to describe this person's fantasies and how the people that he killed would be his slaves in the afterlife. At the end of that message, there were 18 letters that appear to be gibberish, but some people have interpreted those as a signature of sorts and have tried very hard to decipher those symbols into the name of their favored suspect. But that's the only Zodiac cipher that was ever solved. Shortly after that, another cipher arrived. This was a 340-character cipher. That was never solved. There was a 32-character cipher, and then there was a 13-character cipher. Those all remain unsolved, although many people have claimed to have solved them. And usually it's someone who just saw the movie Zodiac and thinks that the code reveals Arthur Leigh Allen's name or something like that.
Yeah.
One of the things that's really interesting, if you're interested, I'm not an expert when it comes to ciphers or cryptograms. I'm very dependent on my friends and other researchers who know a lot more about that than I do. But if you're at all interested in exploring the Zodiac ciphers, I would highly recommend a website called zodiaciphers.com, which has a thing on there called Zodiac Web Toy. And it's an extremely helpful and useful tool where you can pump in your own solution to a Zodiac cipher and test your skills. So if you have at all an interest in pursuing that kind of stuff, you can go on there and spend countless hours doing what many people have done over the years, which is trying to solve what appears to be an uncrackable cipher.
Now, when you look back on this, I've done the interviews and I've heard critical bad reviews of how the police handled the case. Is that your opinion as well?
No. I think that it's very easy to say, and I just want to make a point here. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I was incorrect about that web address. I believe it's zodiackillerciphers.com. But, you know, it's part and parcel for people who have their own Zodiac theories and suspects to run the gamut of news interviews and police departments trying to convince people that they've solved the case. And then when they fail to do so, they have to have an explanation for that. One of the best explanations for people seems to be that it's the police's fault. The police didn't do their job, they won't look at my suspect, or that they botched the case years ago, and that's why you can't solve it now. There's stories that the police were fighting with each other, competing with each other, and things like that. I have studied all the original police reports that are available. I've studied the FBI files. I've interviewed many of the original investigators involved. I've never encountered any evidence that anybody did anything to obstruct the investigation or that they failed to share information with other investigators. There was, in a few instances that I've heard of, some feelings among people that there wasn't enough cooperation, but no one's ever demonstrated any actual instance of that happening. And more importantly, if you do read those police files, what you'll see is that everyone was sharing everything with everyone all the time as much as they could. I spoke to Agent Mel Nicolai from the California Department of Justice, who was in charge of consolidating the investigation and facilitating the cooperation between the various law enforcement agencies. And when I asked him about this theory or this notion that the police didn't cooperate with each other, he described it as, try to be polite here, he described it as absolute BS.
Now, Robert Graysmith seems to be the most popular book about Zodiac and has the biggest influence, obviously, with movies. How do you find his writing? With previous interviews, I've had some criticism on him and suggestion that he's even lied in his book. Is that your opinion as well?
Well, I would probably be a lot more harsh and say that it's not an opinion. Again, as somebody who has studied this case for years, and someone who was introduced to Graysmith's book in 1986 when it came out, someone who initially believed it was a reliable work of nonfiction, I can tell you that the book Zodiac is not a reliable work of nonfiction. It is filled with exaggerations, distortions, selective omissions, and in some cases it appears that the author did invent his own facts to suit his case. You know, he was trying to convince people that his suspect was the Zodiac. And it seems that he went to what might be described as extra honest means to do that. There's an article on my website called Graysmith Unmasked that readers can read there and see just a breakdown of how the book Zodiac and later Zodiac Unmasked match up with the facts. And they don't match up. And there's several instances where it appears that Graysmith invented witnesses who didn't exist. He invented incidents and evidence that didn't exist. One of the most famous examples of this, or perhaps infamous examples, is in his second book, Zodiac Unmasked, which was published in 2002, I believe, he claimed that he had found a hidden road which led from the crime scene straight to the home of his suspect, Arthur Leigh Allen. He claimed that this road was so hard to find that the only way he found it was by making a quick turn on a road, and he ended up at Arthur Leigh Allen's house. Shortly after that book was published, I was in the Bay Area, and we tried to find that road. We checked maps, old maps, new maps. I even called Robert Graysmith myself asking for confirmation on this. Of course, he didn't call me back. But there is no such road, and no such road ever existed. And Robert Graysmith must know that. So that raises a very disturbing question about the reliability of his books.
So why is he still considered kind of the authority? Because he still has the movies and everything still based on his writings.
Well, that's partly because he was the first one to publish a major book. And unfortunately, at the time that his book came out, there was only a handful of reviewers or people who stood up and said, no, that's really not an accurate account, or at best, it's a biased account. Unfortunately, the rest of the media accepted that book as a nonfiction book about a true story. And that became the Zodiac story. People believed what was in that book, and when you see television and newspaper articles, they would often reflect the version of the story that was found in that book. So that became the popular narrative of the case, that became the public perception of the case, and it's dominated public perception ever since. Now, fortunately, over the last 16 or 17 years, there's been a few people out there, like myself and a few others, who have written extensively about the problems with Graysmith and his claims. And it seems to have had enough of an effect to where that has sort of risen to the surface enough where it seems to now at least come up in conversations about it, just like you're asking me today.
So of all the myths and theories out there, and especially all the ones that have been coming out the last few years, do you find anything credible to take back to what you've researched and add it? Is there anything other people are finding out that you find really interesting, intriguing, and worth noting?
Well, I can't say that the intriguing things come from people who, you know, publish books or have theories most of the time. There have been a few instances over the years where people on my message board or other message boards online have come up with really interesting pieces of information that add another layer to your understanding of the Zodiac Killer. One of those is in the Zodiac's first letters, he described using what he used, what he described as an electric gun sight, which he said was taping a pencil flashlight to the barrel of a gun. And if you pointed that gun at someone, there would be a circle of light and a small dark spot in the center. And if you shot, the bullet would go where that dark spot was. And he said something to the effect of, all I had to do was spray them like it was a hose. And for years, the electric gun sight thing has just sort of been one of those details about the Zodiac case that nobody can verify, and no one knows where he came up with that. He's not the first person to come up with the idea of putting a light on top of a gun. But what was really interesting is that a former member of my message board apparently stumbled across this, that in an old episode of Alfred Hitchcock Presents, titled Museum Piece, I believe, there's a story in there with some narration about a guy who's hunting with a rifle that has a light on the top of it. And the narration matches almost word for word what the Zodiac letters said. So it really raises the question whether or not the Zodiac saw that episode and then decided to repeat that himself. The dialogue is so similar that it's almost impossible to believe that he couldn't have known about it. But that's one of the little interesting pieces of information that's come out. There's been others. But when it comes to people who have theories and suspects, especially people who are putting out books, unfortunately, most of the time, while something might sound interesting or compelling, once you start digging into it, it usually falls apart and there's really nothing left to be impressed by.
Yeah, it's tough. And it's something that happened so long ago. What about the theory? I know with, let's see, the recent one was Thomas Horan about the no one person did all the murders. They're all different, and the letters were not written by the same person as well.
Yeah, the hoax theory.
Yeah.
And this is one of those instances where we're using the word theory in its colloquial meaning. Theory meaning like, I have a theory about the Kennedy assassination, you know. It's not like a scientific theory where it has to be proven. It has to be demonstrated to have validity and value before it's accepted as a theory. So the hoax theory, I don't buy at all, and I don't know anyone who does. I don't know how anyone could. If you read the actual police reports, the FBI files, that is not the logical conclusion you will reach. I think some people in their own minds have an idea that if the Zodiac Killer did exist, he must behave in a certain way. If he doesn't behave in the way that they perceive, they therefore conclude that he must not exist. That is not a logical conclusion. That is not an A plus B equals C equation. Reading the Zodiac police reports and FBI files and interviewing people involved and everything, I don't see how anybody could come to the conclusion that it was all a hoax, because that is not what the evidence supports. Of course, there's room for you to doubt whether or not all those crimes were committed by one person. There's room to doubt whether all the letters were written by one person. But it's not the most logical conclusion, it's not the most plausible conclusion, and it's not the most likely conclusion that it was all a hoax. Especially when you consider that there are some instances where this hoax theory, at least as far as I've heard it, falls apart in trying to connect the dots between four different police jurisdictions, at least four different police jurisdictions involved. How somebody could get access to the piece of the cab driver's shirt, include them in letters, when the letters began shortly after the second crime and the piece of the cab driver's shirt was connected to the fourth crime in a different police jurisdiction. I've heard theories that a reporter must have done it or something like that. None of that makes any sense. And I would compare it to someone who comes home to find that their house has been burglarized, and they look down and they see that there's some dust on the floor, and they immediately conclude that it must have been a mummy. That is not the most logical conclusion to draw from that. So when you have some unanswered questions, or there are some facts about the Zodiac letters or crimes that you are unable to reconcile in your own mind, the most logical conclusion is not that it was a hoax. And especially when you consider the fact that the person who's perpetuating this hoax theory has made a lot of accusations about people, which some are demonstrably false that I know of, and others are completely unsubstantiated. He's basically just filling in the gaps of his own knowledge with his imagination. That's not the same thing as credible research.
And another one was, just recently we had John Cameron on twice, and he wrote about the serial killer Edward Wayne Edwards. And the suggestion was that he could perhaps be the Zodiac as well, because he traveled all across the states murdering. And you know, we've had people that suggest their father or grandfather were.
Oh, yeah. That's part of what you call the daddy did it syndrome now. People are accusing their stepfathers, their real fathers, family members, high school acquaintances. I'm not all that familiar with the individual that you're talking about, but I am familiar with the theory about Edwards. There's no credible evidence linking him to that crime whatsoever. And that's the problem with a lot of these people who have these kinds of theories. They sound really good, but in the end, they're not substantiated by anything, and it's mostly a guessing game or someone just saying, this is what I think happened. But I've never seen any credible evidence to suggest that Edwards was involved in any of the Zodiac crimes at all.
Have you ever narrowed down a suspect for yourself or anybody you think is the person that was behind Zodiac?
No, there's only been one person who ever seriously interested me. He's someone who was not one of the popular named suspects, and he's not a name that you would hear. And there's not enough credible evidence for me to justify saying his name on the air, although his name has apparently been tossed around lately online. But it was an individual who had... someone had reported him to the police, and the information that I could come across was enough for me to be interested in him. I never found any credible evidence that he was involved. I've never been able to find any credible evidence to prove that he wasn't involved. But that's the only person that I've ever even slightly been attracted to, at least in the last 20-something years. In the beginning, I was like many other people. I didn't know a lot about the case, so I was often impressed by people who presented evidence against their suspects. And I would think, oh, wow, that's compelling. It looks like he might have solved the case. And then now I'm just much more weary of those kinds of claims. And because I have done so much research on it, I'm usually able to check on it very quickly and discover there's nothing to it.
So what do you think happened to Zodiac? I mean, I guess we can never know, really. Do you think he's dead? Do you think he survived? He's just doing something different. Where do you think it ended up?
You know, that's a really tough question, because I don't know for sure whether I'm answering it with my gut or my brain.
Yeah.
You know, I'd like to believe that the Zodiac is still out there. We could identify him. I'm not sure that that will happen. I'm not sure that it can happen now with so much time that has gone by. But one thing that's important to remember is over the last 20, 30 years, there were at least three major unsolved serial killer cases in America. There was the Zodiac, the Green River Killer, and the BTK Strangler. The BTK Strangler was somewhat similar to Zodiac in the sense that he wrote letters and ciphers, and he even called the police at one point to report a crime. And the Green River Killer was famous for murdering women who were working as prostitutes. So they're not similar in that regard. But during the period when these cases was unsolved all these years, when these cases were unsolved all these years, there was often a lot of expert opinions about what became of these people, what kind of people they were in the first place. And we were often told that these were people who were loners, who were incapable of maintaining employment or incapable of maintaining relationships with women, that they were probably, mentally disturbed and things like that. And that was the popular theory about BTK and about the Green River Killer. So it was very telling when those two individuals were finally identified. The BTK killer was identified as Dennis Rader, who was a city control officer, an animal control officer, and the president of his church. And it turned out that he had been involved in many of these crimes over the years, including crimes which some FBI experts had determined were not connected to the BTK murders. When they identified Gary Ridgway as the Green River Killer. It turned out that he'd been married all that time, that he'd had the same job all that time. So a lot of the conceptions that we have about these kinds of people often turn out to be wrong. It's very possible that the same could be true of the Zodiac. And if he is still out there, I would very much like to know who he is. There's very few things in life that would make me that happy.
Yeah, I almost think that it's too far gone, that we'll never really get an answer for this.
That's possible. I worry about it often, that because people are constantly being told by the media that the case has been solved, that someone out there who has a piece of information which could be extremely useful will now believe that it doesn't matter. And so I really would like people to keep in mind that the case is unsolved, and there could be a person out there who knows something. There could be a person, as one police detective said one time, maybe their uncle or their grandfather passes away and leaves a box of odd, strange items in the carport, you know. And one of them could be the hood worn by the killer or the driver's license belonging to the cab driver. If that happened, we could solve the case. But the only way that person would come forward is if they believed the case had not been solved. And unfortunately, that's not what you hear in the media.
Did anybody really come up with a good theory of why he called himself Zodiac?
Not really. There's a lot of different theories about why that name was used, what it could possibly mean. There's a theory that the killer used that because there was a watch, a Zodiac brand watch, that had the name Zodiac and the crossed circle symbol on it. However, the word Zodiac is traditionally associated with astrology. And in astrology, the crossed circle symbol represents the Zodiac, the astrological Zodiac. There's a famous piece of video where a member of law enforcement is saying that they checked out this with people who are knowledgeable about astrology, and they were told that that symbol is considered the sign of the Zodiac in astrology. So I think the astrological symbol explanation is more likely than others, but that's just a possible explanation. That doesn't explain how he chose his name. There is a 1933 movie called Charlie Chan at Treasure Island, where the villain calls himself Dr. Zodiac and writes odd letters and notes. It's possible that he could have been inspired by that. But I don't think anybody can say with certainty where the inspiration for that came from.
And is there any one big thing, myth or something you hear on the internet or just in the media that is completely wrong and that should be corrected?
Wow. There's so many. There's a few big ones. And a lot of them, unfortunately, have to do with Arthur Leigh Allen because of Robert Graysmith's books. One of the big myths is that the Zodiac letters stopped while Arthur Leigh Allen was in prison and began again as soon as he got out. What most people don't seem to realize when they're peddling that theory or repeating it is that the period between 1971 and 1974, when there were no Zodiac letters, Arthur Leigh Allen was not in prison. So the absence of Zodiac letters does not indicate some connection to him being in prison. The letters in 1974 appeared to be the last known Zodiac letters, so at least the last suspected authenticated Zodiac letters. And then there was the letter in 1978. That letter came in April of 1978. But during television interviews and radio interviews, Robert Graysmith repeatedly says that they received the first Zodiac letter in years the day after Arthur Leigh Allen was released from prison. And that's not true. Arthur Leigh Allen was apparently, if I remember correctly, released in August of 1977. And that Zodiac letter arrived in April of 1978. That's a lot longer than one day. But when you tell that story and say that it came one day after he was released, it sure does make it sound like Arthur Leigh Allen probably sent that letter. And that's the way it is with a lot of things when it comes with Gray Smith and Arthur Leigh Allen. You'll hear that Allen confessed to many of his friends, when that's not true, that he wore wing walkers like the killer. There's no evidence that he wore wing walkers or even owned wing walkers. There's many other myths that are persistent out there, especially when it comes to things like shooting at Blue Rock Springs. There's people who believe that Darlene Farren was stalked by someone prior to the murders, that this person was confronted her at Blue Rock Springs and called her out by name. None of that, there's no credible evidence to support those conclusions. The person who survived that night said that the killer just walked up and started shooting and walked away without saying a word. There's no credible evidence that Darlene Farren was stalked by anyone. There's no evidence that she was killed by anyone that she knew. These are just some of the persistent myths. Another one, as you can see on my website, if you go there, click on Zodiac Killer Facts and click on Myths and Legends, you'll see articles about all of these subjects. There's a myth that the Zodiac Killer called attorney Melvin Belli at his home and said, "Today is my birthday," on the day of Arthur Leigh Allen's birthday. That is part of Robert Graysmith's narrative about Allen. But when you look at the actual FBI files, it indicates the actual phone call we're talking about took place in February, not in December, when Arthur Leigh Allen was born. So those are just a few of them. I'm sure if I had written them out ahead of time, I could have come up with something better than that. But those are some of the things that really annoy me, because if you actually do some research, you'll find out those things aren't true. And it's not uncommon for me to be reading some message board or website comments, or even on Facebook. Like the other day, someone posted something about this meme that Ted Cruz is the Zodiac Killer. And the person online there responded, "Hey, you guys know that they know who the Zodiac was, and he died right when they were about to arrest him." And that's a reference to Arthur Leigh Allen. Now, there's no credible evidence that indicates Arthur Leigh Allen was responsible for the Zodiac crimes, and there's nothing but credible evidence to indicate that he wasn't involved. But even more importantly, there's no evidence that they were going to arrest him just before he died. That myth has been around for a while, largely because of a off-the-cuff remark by one police officer at that time. But there's no evidence that they were planning to do that, and much more importantly, there was no evidence to justify arresting him. At that time, all they had was this questionable identification by a surviving victim and some stories. And handwriting experts determined repeatedly that Arthur Leigh Allen did not write the Zodiac letters. One of the police officers who said that he saw the Zodiac leaving the scene of the last known Zodiac murder said without doubt that Arthur Leigh Allen was not the person that he saw. But these myths persist, and they persist for the very reason we were talking about earlier, which is the book and the movie have cemented these things in the public mind, and they become facts because they're not challenged. So people will repeat it, and then, of course, they'll stumble across some website like mine, and because they read this in a book or saw it in a movie, they think that I don't know what I'm talking about, which is really ironic.
Yeah. Well, fascinating subject. Okay, let's give out your contact information and website.
You can reach me at contact@zodiackillerfacts.com, and my website is zodiackillerfacts.com. That provides a reality-based, fact-based examination of the case where you can find the original police reports, the FBI files, all kinds of other official documents, the crime scene photographs and other photographs related to the case, and most especially where you can read the Zodiac letters themselves at the document gallery on my website. And also you can find fact-based, thorough articles about most of the major subjects related to the Zodiac case.
Fascinating subject, and it's been really good talking to you. Michael Butterfield, writer and Zodiac expert. Thanks for being on the show.
Well, thanks for having me on. I enjoyed it.
Show is over for now.
Was it as good for you as it was for me?
Well, good night. This has been a production of the Z-Talk Radio Network.
I'll be back.